Sorry, it just came up in the chat. Thank you, whoever put that in there asking about the recording. I just now hit the recording started on that. We're not going to revamp everything we just covered, but from this point on, everything's going to be recorded, and we will be making this available on Grimco's YouTube page. So go ahead and like, subscribe to that YouTube page so you get the latest content that we're putting out here. I'll post it up there as full unedited, so hopefully some fun, interesting things happen while we're doing this presentation live. But then I'll also later on break it down into small, useful segments too. So. I should have covered some quick housekeeping things early on in the beginning too. We're going to cover this first portion about an hour, 45 minutes or so. We're going to take a quick break, maybe 10, 15 minute break. And then we're going to do another 45 minutes, and we're going to leave 15 minutes at the end for Q&A. So please don't wait till the end of the 15 minutes. Use the Q&A chat. This is Q&A, right? Use the Q&A button to go ahead and enter questions early. This way, if there's something you are thinking about, you want us to expand on, drop in the Q&A so we make sure we cover it at the end too. Okay, let's continue.
Okay, great. So I'm going to hop into Illustrator. And in Illustrator, I want to start out by talking and identifying that spot color, that source color. And again, it could be a spot color that's a custom made color, or it could be a Pantone color. So I'm going to start out by going over to my swatch panel. Now we do have a particular red color.
Not sharing your screen.
Oh, there we go. Now I got it. Okay. So here I am in Illustrator. Very good. We're there. In Illustrator, I got my swatch panel open here on the right. And we do have a swatch color for the Grimco Red. This is a Pantone color, and we can see the color type is spot color, not a process build. Now, the big difference between that is going to be how that color type, spot or process, is going to be recognized by the RIP software. In this case, we're talking about Onyx RIP software, and in Onyx RIP software, we have the Pantone library of colors. So when this Pantone color comes over to our RIP is going to recognize that Pantone name and give the true Pantone representation by Pantone to print that color. When that color prints, are we matching the Pantone in the guidebook or not? That's the next step in debate we have to evaluate and find out. This Pantone color was called up out of Illustrator from the color book. We can access that by the swatches flyout menu at the bottom, open swatch library, and then at the top, color books. Now, this is a representation of these preset Pantone libraries. A common one might be the solid coded library of colors. And this is going to show us all of the different Pantones in here. And of course, we can click on a color and add that to our swatch library. This is referencing Pantone's color book from Pantone. So this is the color world that we're in, and we're referencing this color guide. If for some reason we need to generate a new swatch and make that as a spot color, but the name is a unique name. For example, I use in one of my training files a logo red, and this might have some sort of representation for that color model. It could be RGB, it could be CMYK, or even an LAB measurement. Now, LAB color measurements could be drawn in or measured from, gathered from a spectrophotometer, and we will talk about a spectrophotometer today. But be that as it may, just to show you and illustrate a point that we can make a new swatch. It will be a spot color, but the name could be this custom branded logo. Not everything is Pantone. Sometimes we have these brand colors in our marketing, in our industry, and we would name this as it needs to be named to identify that. Now, this logo red color name, I'm going to add this in here just to have it in the file. This is definitely a Pantone color. This is definitely a spot color, spot color name, but it's a unique name as it is different than the Pantone. In our world, we can have spot colors that are Pantones. We could have spot colors that are custom designed colors. Still remaining through this is going to be our workflow. When we save this file and when we bring it through to the RIP, how will the Onyx RIP software interpret that data? And when we print, how will our print sample match to the target or goal color?
Real quick, just so I can kind of clarify, you know, this is my understanding and work of this process. How a color is named is really important because it allows you to print it on multiple devices, multiple medias, and adjust that color to get what you want. So by starting with a Pantone value, that's a known color. Mm-hmm. When a color is set up as a process color, so if I switch this over to process and it gives me CMYK or RGB, you know, typically CMYK is your value. If you're only printing on one printer and you're only printing on one media, that color is going to be what it is. Mm-hmm. It's basically like a non-known entity. Whereas when you switch over to calling things Pantone values, it kind of gives it a better starting point, like a known value that it's trying to hit. But then it also allows you to adjust that color down the road because it's called out. The RIP software recognizes it as a thing that you're trying to achieve. So you can do adjustments to it. It's a lot easier than working with just a process color.
Right, definitely.
And in the real world, you know, not all of our prints are going to come over with Pantone values called out. It's actually a fairly rare thing, but when you have a certain color that you're trying to adjust to, you know, a customer's the green in their logo or the blue in their, you know, a picture that they're trying to print, by working with it as a spot color, it makes the adjustment process easier. You can hit any color on the rainbow. You're not likely going to hit 22 different or how many things we have open in our library there. Yes. You're not going to make adjustments for all of those colors, but the two or three or maybe only one color that's really important, if you work with it as a spot color, you know, hopefully a Pantone value, a called out Pantone value, or a named spot color, it makes it a lot easier to kind of work with those colors and do some adjustments.
And where that relates in Onyx is in our color library. So in Onyx, under setup, RIP configuration, color matching table, Onyx has this color table, color library. Pantone colors are in there, but we can also eventually add our logo colors that we want to identify in there for the recipe replacement. So this color matching table, the first tab we're going to see is our system defined colors, and this is the Pantone library. So as Neil's saying, when we design as Pantone and it comes through the RIP, the name is going to be identified exactly as that name match here. And an important aspect is we are using the color books in Illustrator. We're truly using the color library in Illustrator. So the naming convention is appropriate. Pantone, all uppercase, a space bar, the number, a space bar, and then the designation, C for coded. There's a lot of different varieties down here, and I'll probably be better if I pull the slider down. Many, many different representations, uncoded. There's PC, CV, CVS, there's RAL colors, TPX colors, colors that are used that are describing in Pantone worldwide, not just what we use in maybe in the United States, but a lot of different color recipes that are described. The naming designation, right down to the full letter, again, you know, Pantone, all uppercase, space bar 130, space bar, and then the capital C or the capital RAL or whatever that identifying property is, the full express name, case and space sensitive, will be recognized. And this will be the replacement for that color to give us the true recipe.
So if we look at in my swatch library I have over here, the Grimco Pantone 7621C with the space, all that correct, and called out as a spot color. So if I wanted to print this on a banner, I wanted to print this on some self-adhesive vinyl, a couple different machines, but I want that red, that Grimco red to always look the same. Because I have it called out as a spot color, it'll be nice and easy for me to adjust. Or, you know, maybe I don't even have to adjust it because my RIP and my
color management
output
profile
device is just spot on with that color. That's what we're working here, is to manage that color. So anybody who's doing a lot of print work for Grimco and you want to make sure you're representing that red correctly, that's the way to follow through with it.
That's the number. So when we take a look at the settings here, it's all about the exact naming convention. If there's going to be a color like logo red, and it just happens to be this type of red, and one of your clients says match this red, and it's called logo red, we're not conforming to the Pantone, but it still is a valid spot color that we need to match. Once we get through our examples today with working with swatch books, that logo red name, case and space sensitive, will be added to the print mode library. And that's going to be based on the recipe we determine as the match. And we're going to come back to that. But I do want to identify the Pantone library information. This whole color matching table that we see here with all three tabs will be active, engaged, accessible, functioning, or turned on when we have in our quick set this checkbox on. use spot color replacement table. When that checkbox is on, set up RIP configuration color matching table, that menu we were just in with the system defined colors will be activated. Those three tabs are activated. The main component that is going to be applied will be when we rip a file that has a spot color with that name and the name matches the description, it uses our spot color matching library recipe. It ignores the data from Illustrator and uses our recipe to identify that color. Okay, so that's a big part of understanding that. And our spot color table checkbox is on. This checkbox is on by default in our default quick set. So right there, that's just a little bit about talking about identifying spot color versus process, what the differences are, and really in relationship to the name. All about that name has to exactly match. So logo red, capital L, lowercase OGO, spacebar, capital R, R, lowercase RED. So we have exact case and space sensitive. It's going to do the replacement swap out. Now, this can be a wonderful way of replacing your recipes in your color, in your files. Once we get that match and we go through the software, identify the library of colors in our file in the RIP, we have this information being replaced time and time again. It's just a matter of maintaining process control and maintaining typical things, you know, temperature, humidity, printer condition, and we will be able to get that recipe repeating over and over and over again. So when we think about trying to match a certain target or goal color, we're also going to take a look and think about, besides the spot color and the spot color name, we're also going to think about general color management rules. So a few things that are going to apply in the Onyx RIP workstation. When we go through our RIP, there's going to be a conversion of input to output. And that we're going to see in our default quick set, because we have this color management section, our default is all ICC profiles on. When we have all ICC profiles on, the file that we bring into the RIP will go through a conversion. And this is called the profile connection space, PCS. This conversion process typically happens in a RIP, and this can also be negated or disabled. This is something that we can have all ICC profiles on. We're engaging in the profile connection space, or we can have this set to off, all ICC profiles off. We're disabling that. Now let's get into what this really, really means. When we have all ICC profiles on, I'm going to click on the Change Profiles button. What's going to show me in the screen is I'm going to use the embedded profile of my file coming into the RIP. The embedded profile will be honored and represented. But if my file I'm bringing into the RIP does not contain an embedded profile, it's considered untagged, then it's going to use in CMYK Imager Vector this preset, US Web Coded Swap version 2. If it's an RGB Imager Vector, it's going to use this preset, sRGB. Now, where this comes from is Onyx is matching the Adobe Creative Suite default. And we're doing this a bit as a preset. Most everyone's using Adobe Creative Suite, Photoshop, Illustrator, InDesign. So what we're doing is we are defaulting to the default color space in those programs, in those products. And I'll show you where that is. I'm going to switch over to Photoshop.
And I'll tell you, Matt Crawford with Onyx, I sat through a color management training session with him once, and he described this process. It made so much sense as soon as he said it. Basically, you're trying to match the box of crayons. So when you're designing something in Photoshop, Illustrator, any of the Adobe Suite products, that design program is using a 164 box of crayons with the sharpener built into the side, really nice setup. On your RIP software, as well as your output device, you want to match that box of crayons. You don't want to color with the three crayon set that they give you at Applebee's. Yeah. Like you want to use that same 128 box or whatever, how many crayons you got in the box with the sharpener and everything. And so making sure that your design software and your RIP software are coloring with the same box of crayons is the way to go.
Yes, absolutely. And so in Photoshop, edit color settings will let us see what that default is. In the Creative Suite programs, the default is North America General Purpose 2. Now, if we look directly below, we can see the working space or input profile. This is defaulting to sRGB and US Web Code Swap. We in Onyx are matching the exact preset of what Adobe matches. And again, the reasons are just as you said, Adobe is the number one product that's used out there. We want to try to assume the same color recipe data that we would have created if we embedded the data, embedded that profile. So we're going to assume that standard information.
Now, so best practice is go into your Adobe, your design software, and see what your settings are. Make sure they match what you're doing in your RIP. A realistic scenario is you didn't do the design work and your customer designed it and you have no idea what their settings were. Maybe it's a high-end photography client that does some work in Photoshop and he has some special settings because he's got a desktop printer and he changed his default Adobe settings. When you go to print that same artwork, you're not getting it. It's not coming out looking like what you're seeing on your screen. Play around with those, the Onyx settings. So it's, you want to try to match. If you can figure out what the original was done in, great. It's easy to match it, or just play around the settings in there, your rendering intents until you get the match.
And that information, again, in Adobe is edit color settings. And it's when we go in here, this is where we can see the preset. And another point to make, typically we're not sitting at one computer, one station in our shop. We have several computers, several people in Photoshop, Illustrator, InDesign. Whatever those standards are that you want to use as a starting point here for color management, you want to make sure that the other softwares on this computer are also in that same compliance. And that the other computers, the other stations that are there as well. If I am in North America General Purpose 2, if you are in North America General Purpose 2, but then someone else is using a different setting in here, which is giving us a whole different aspect of input profile color space, and they embed that, like you're saying, and we go into the RIP, use embedded profile when available. Now, our output result might look the same, but theirs might look different. So consistency is a big part of it. You want to make sure whatever it is that you want these settings to be in your desktop application, that everyone in that desktop department, in those software programs, Adobe, Illustrator, InDesign, you're all kind of complying and you're matching. And that's an important aspect too, because if one of you is different, then their output results may be different. Now, there's a whole lot more to get into and expand upon, but we don't want to lose focus on swatch books here.
We only have 2 hours here.
Yeah, there's a lot more to talk about.
Nice exposure to the design side. It starts with the design. And so a lot of times that's where the RIP's going to do what the RIP wants to do. And if you got to understand how it complies with what you did in design.
So getting back into this concept of our color management, all ICC profiles on. I've got a little PowerPoint file here just to kind of show. Typically, we're talking about these different color spaces. We've got sRGB, Adobe RGB 1998, Profoto, several different aspects. But then we have what we're trying to output, a matte paper or a self-adhesive vinyl. Those gamuts and those shapes are much different. So we need to somehow reckon with how we're going to take all that color and convert into our output. A lot of times we're thinking of these color spaces as these shapes. So we have an sRGB, we have a US Web Code Swap. When we put these together, we can see where our colors that are in our vast input file may not be incorporated in our output profile, our media profile. So this is where we have rendering intents. And that's another aspect to consider. What do we want our rendering intent to be set to? This is how we're going to manipulate the color that's not in our gamut to get it to be represented in our output gamut. And again, there's defaults. Relative color metric is the default in the Adobe programs. But just to illustrate a little bit of a point, perceptual will pull all of your color and move it all in spatially to become represented. Now that's pleasing color. Color is moving. But it's not accurate color, but it's pleasing color, and it all depends on what type of printing you're doing. On the other side, on the far right, we've got saturation intent. That is designed to try to get as much possible color, chroma, that we can represent. And maybe that's good for graphics and charts and illustrations and logos. But in the end, when we're thinking about trying to represent input data to output data, value for value, that's going to be our color metric rendering intent. And that's another example here to show you perceptual, take all that color that's out of gamut and bring it in, colors that are in gamut move over to allow for that smooth transition between those colors. And we get a nice spatial, pleasing, perceptual color result. On the left, otherwise, we have relative color metric. Whatever our value is in the input file matches to the output, we're going to get that exact match. Any color that's out of that gamut is just kind of brought into that edge, right? It's just brought into that very edge value. Relative color metric, we're really maintaining value for value, input to output, where it's suited. Perceptual is bringing all that color in pleasing. Now, when we talk about this input to output conversion, and this is where I wanted to get to, when we have all ICC profiles on, in a RIP, we are going through this profile connection space. And what this does is it takes our input file, RGB, for example. Typically, we're working a lot in RGB as our source files. We're getting them from digital cameras or something to that effect. We're taking that RGB and we're converting this to the through the profile connection space. That's getting converted to our LAB recipe. And then from LAB, it's converting to our output profile. So our photo paper, our self-adhesive vinyl, our canvas, that's our output media profile. When we go through this conversion space, this profile connection space, the value of our source is going to be different to the value of our output. We are going to see a difference. And I often give the example, if I had a 50% cyan tint in my file, when it comes through the RIP, through the profile connection space, color management's being applied, and I might have a 52% cyan, 4% magenta, 1% yellow. The conversion will make a difference in the recipe. It is for this reason, and we're going to come back to this topic, when we have our preset all ICC profiles on, we're going through this profile connection space, but there is a conversion of input to output. Okay, so let's take a look at the difference. When I have all ICC profiles on, we can see in change profiles, we are going through a conversion. We are using embedded profile when available, but if it's not available, we're going to use what our preset would be back in Adobe. So that's a nice match right there. If I turn all ICC profiles off, and then I go back into change profiles, you will see my menus are negated, disabled, not being applied. So we are disabling the profile connection space. Our value of our input file is going to come through the RIP. It will not convert to LAB and then convert to our output profile. It's just going to take that value as it is and represent it passing through.
So a lot of times if I'm working with a Photoshop file where I know the customer did some tweaking of the Photoshop file, that's what I'll do is turn all ICC profiles off. And basically you're letting Photoshop drive the conditions.
Yep. We're honoring the data.
Onyx is doing bare minimum to adjust things at all. So.
Yep. We're actually taking the values as they are from that art file and just passing them through. So this is where a 50% cyan tint will be a 50% cyan tint at our RIP level, if you will, when we look at that in Job Editor, for example. Yep. So that's the representation taking place.
You know, another common use of this one too is you're dealing with gradients, mm-hmm. transparencies and gradients, and you run a physical print of it, and the gradient kind of has blocky choppiness to it. Sometimes just a simple matter of changing your rendering intent is going to solve that issue for you. So,
and I'm going to put this back to the preset and mentioning that as well. Back in those Photoshop or Adobe Creative Suite settings, a big part should be, if that is taking place, check your black point compensation. You should be getting the full checkbox on as a default, full dynamic space of your source being converted to your output. I would think it would be, but yet to say that is something to consider, to see that it's not disabled in the file. When it comes to things like that with smooth transitions, in some cases, it could be the way the gradient was created or how smooth our profile is created with the gradients as well, with being blended data when we're measuring with our devices, creating our profile or using a provided profile. The data points and all that aspect should be a good smooth transition. But still, having said that, trying to turn off all ICC profiles off and seeing the result, you're bypassing that conversion, and maybe that's going to be making some type of a difference.
Right. And okay. That's kind of that sample, that beaker you just, if you want to cover those, how we got those three.
Yes. So let me cancel out of that and go back into here. So we've got three files that I've opened up and we've actually printed. These three files have a different embedded RGB input profile. This first file, and I put them in the name so there's no mystery. The first one is sRGB. The second one is an Adobe RGB 1998. And the third one is Profoto. Now these three, I'm just gonna tab through them. sRGB, Adobe RGB, Profoto. sRGB, Adobe, Profoto. So even on your monitors, you'll see differences. This is just to illustrate the point that yes, different embedded profiles will have an impact on how that image is going to reproduce.
And so I went ahead and ran these three prints on the exact same device. And on the, do you want to hit stop share real quick?
Oh, yeah, hang on 1 sec, everybody.
There we go. So I ran them on the exact same device and ran them with the exact same profile and did LED on assisted the default rendering on here. And hopefully it'll show well on camera, but there's a distinct difference between what the profile, how it outputs that. And that's just from my design application being set up a different way. And so if a customer's handing you a matched print, they're saying, hey, match this, you know, I want this to look exactly like that on banner, on self-adhesive, on foam board, whatever you're printing your substrate onto, just know that, hey, how that photo was rendered in is going to make a difference in how it outputs. Matching those, your 128 box of crayons versus your three crayon set that comes with your meal at Applebee's.
And that aspect, the comparison with the crayons, that's a very good analogy. A lot of times we think about that, like, well, what's my color that I have to color with? And if I've just got, 16 colors to work with, I can pull out maybe two red examples and maybe two or three green examples. If I've got 128 crayons with the sharpener on the side, when I say pull out a red crayon, I might be able to pull out seven different shades of the red color or the green or something. So the difference is really, in that example, is how much color representation do I have? If I can try to have as much color on the front end to be represented on the back end, and if I can accomplish that, that's really the goal. If I can get all my color in my source file to be represented in my output, it's perfect match. It's perfect predictability, perfect match. It's the world we love.
The ideal scenario is what you're seeing on your screen is what you're seeing on your print that's coming out of your machine.
We can represent.
And Onyx is that interface in between. So. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so let's take a look at working through our settings with swatchbooks. Right, we've got this example. We want to go through and try to match a certain green. Go ahead and
share the screen here. So Onyx is a really powerful tool for coming up with that color mix. Okay, so a customer dropped this off at our shop and said, hey, I need 1,000 of these printed on 4x8 banners, and I need this green color to match. And so here I have a Pantone 368 is what it is. And this may be a case where the customer's file is not called a Pantone at all. It's a CMYK value. But me as the production guy, I have to match this color. So easiest way to color management is work in Pantone values or work in those spot colors, those named colors in there. And so customer hands me this thing, maybe the file has Pantone called on it and maybe the file doesn't. I have to do some color adjustments. I ran a small proof and it's not quite the green they were looking for. So the first thing I'm going to do, and more likely this is my great workflow, is I'm going to pull out my Pantone book, available at grimco.com. This is a Pantone, pulled up here. So this color coded Pantone book, grimco.com, you can order them today. Hopefully we have them in stock. I don't think Pantone books have been affected by the supply chain management of COVID so much. So, but great place to start with color management. So I'm going to pull out my Pantone book. And I'm going to take this book and I'm going to fan through here and I'm going to try to find the closest match to this green that the customer has. At that point, I have a starting point. I have a known value. So then I'm going to go in my file and I'm going to make sure it's named Pantone 368. And then what can we do? What can we use Onyx for from that point?
So when we evaluate, okay, let's pull that guy forward. Put him on here. When we evaluate our print sample, I want to zoom in a little bit, maybe.
Hit stop share.
Okay. We're going to let you guys get a close-up look to this. So when we evaluate how are we matching or not matching in our patches? We need to print the sample first and see what we're getting as a result. And then we're going to compare it to the target or goal color. Now, the target object is the Pantone guidebook in this case. So we want to evaluate this and see, how are we not matching? When we evaluate the color, it's an important thing to remember the surrounding light in the room that you're evaluating this color in. Many of you probably have some type of light box to go into to judge that color, right? To evaluate that in the true sense of where you want that to be. But when we're looking at this, we want to do a little evaluation to see, how am I not matching that color? And in our software, Swatch Books, we have four conditions. We have a lightness condition, we have a chroma, we have a saturation, and a hue option. And those are the way we can manipulate the color output to try to get closer to the target, which is the Pantone guidebook. Okay, so now do that share.
Down at the bottom, share screen.
Okay, here we go, gotcha.
Share.
All right, so in the software, we know we've got this Pantone 368. We're going to go ahead and select up at the top. We're going to go into Swatch Books.
This is a really neat tool. Rather than guessing, you know, at the end of the day, we want to come up with a CMYK formula that is going to allow our output device to match this color. Rather than guessing, okay, it's plus or minus 5% magenta or 2% red or cyan, whatever. This allows me to generate a quick swatch around that range of color. So you want to do 368.
So
looks like we're all set. So I chose my device.
Yeah, we need
so
to pick
printing
the,
printing this on my Epson S40. It's Epson's CMYK. So it's a four color printer, solvent printer. I chose my media, which is 3M, and I'm doing IJ35, nice removable. If you only use one film, IJ35 is a great film for most things. So we choose the print mode that we're going to run this at. Four pass, six pass, eight pass, whatever we want to try to run to meet our production needs. And then we're going to generate a swatch book based on a spot color. So this, our file, we went ahead and changed that color to Pantone 368, or it came in already named as 368.
So I'll go to 368 to search and pick that color. And again, as you see, different representations through different libraries from Pantone. So 368, I'll hit OK. So an important point is Neil is saying we need to identify, what printer did I print on? What's the media? What's the mode? Every aspect of that, because that is the details of that profile. So we need to set those conditions up. We're picking the Pantone color. We are trying to hit Pantone. We're picking this from our library. Now, when I click OK, our Swatch Books is going to open up. And we start with that source color. The type of patches we can generate, starting out, we have a one-dimension patch, just one change. And again, you might evaluate this and say, oh, it's hue all day long. And so we can make one dimension of change, and we can pick that category type to being a hue alteration. The number of patches and the patch size, you can always think of your roll of your material you have. I've got a 53-inch roll, roughly. I do want to do like 1-inch patch or 2-inch patches. You want to have enough of an area of coverage when we print those patches that we can see the color effect. So 1-inch, 2 inches, our maximum is 3 inches of a print patch. The quantity of patches, in this case, we know we want to accomplish 1 degree of change. We might as well take advantage of the whole width of the roll. So 53.3 inches with that label gap of 0.1, patch gap of 0.1, I might be able to get away with about maybe 50 patches in there to do this. If we go beyond bounds, when we go to print, it'll tell us that that's too many patches to fit in your width. So we can whittle that number down a little bit. But the idea could be, I want to take advantage of that whole width. I'm just doing one row of change. I've got the width. It's free space. Let's print in that area.
And the more patches you do, the more range it's going to give you. So when we look at, you know, this patch on the left-hand side, all the way to the right side, by increasing the patch size, it expands it out. It does hue by a varying degree here. So let's do a 1 degree of hue from left to right. Now that's less color it's giving me there. When I expand it out to a plus minus of 10, the range it's going to go,
bigger
it's going to give me, is going to give me bigger steps in between. So, and then likewise, we can go two dimensional, which allows me, I'm not jumping ahead, am I?
No, you're fine. Okay. You're fine. Yeah. and then change that 50 there. Yeah, swipe it. I'll tell it that. Yeah. Well, there you go.
Okay. So now we changed it. We went two dimensional, which allows us to vary two factors or two variables here. So lightness and chroma, we could maybe do lightness and hue, and you can kind of see there's a shift in your color. So this original color, this device value right here, this CMYK formula, is somewhere right here in the middle. You know, that actual number would pop up on here, and these are going to give you actual numbers. So you can see actual CMYK values are called out in there, and that number is somewhere in the middle, and we got a plus minus going this way, plus minus going that way to all four corners. So that this is going to automatically generate a nice variation of Pantone 368 mm-hmm. we're working with mm-hmm. on that device for this media. And so from here, I never use three-dimensional, but I'll show it just for fun.
Yeah.
Three-dimensional is way too much color options.
Our hue to
chroma.
Yeah.
Okay. There's way too many. I don't need that many options available to me, but it's given me a variation. I have no idea where that original source value is.
Yeah,
it's somewhere on this page.
Yeah.
But it's giving you in every which way, shape, and form.
Our additional pages would alter in this case by chroma. So that's going to be the variation. And of course, we can have extra pages and pages of data. You know, sometimes you think about more changes. You're chasing the correction cycle. So sometimes making small changes is good. If we just do like maybe, oh, I think it could be saturation, it could be chroma. Well, let's do one of each. We can do one of each and then see where we go. Yeah. And if we do feel there's a two direction change, maybe we just take it down to that small direction of two and we see where we're at. But a lot of times just doing one simple change until you kind of start to see where that transition is could be helpful too.
Yeah,
it's one of those things where it just depends. It's all case by case. And it depends on when you're working through this.
And so at this point, I'm going to print this visual swatch. I always recommend turning on the print label here. This way you have on the actual prints you're working on, it tells you exactly what printer, what print mode. It's going to give you all of this information on that swatch. And we can print it here. And it's going to generate it. I'll send it into my rip queue. And then I can hit print on my printer and it'll run this off. And so I've already done that.
Yeah.
This is like that cooking show where they already have the casserole ready to go. And so I printed off. You want to hit the stop?
Oh, yeah, you got it. Yep.
So I printed off this visual swatch. So I have a range, you know, my original source value somewhere here in the middle, and it deviates left, right, top, bottom.
Here, I'll
and
hold
so
this
now, in yeah, there we go. So now I can take my water over. So now I can take my original Pantone book and move that around on my sheet and try to come up with the best match that comes in there. This is a pro tip right here. I have this little piece of self-adhesive vinyl with a square cut out of it. Looking at all this color in kind of one big shape isn't going to do a lot of good for me.
Ooh,
my eyes are going to go cross-eyed right away. Whereas if I take this little blocker here, let's see if I can zoom in on that a little bit. Probably not going to show great. I can't run. But I zoom in, I got that little blocker there. It's isolating those two stretches of color. And don't move. All right, perfect. Isolates those two blocks of color. I'm only seeing those. I'm seeing white space outside of there. And it makes it nice and easy to pick a color. The next thing I'm going to do is grab my marker and immediately circle that CMYK value that I liked and that looks good to me. So now I have a perfect match for this material printed on that machine that's going to match up and have my green print the way I want it to print. I want to switch back over to Onyx and we'll show the next step.
Yes. And the patch itself has that color recipe printed below it. So the key part here now is I'm going to hop back into swatch books again real quick here.
I think you're about to show me something I don't even know. That's why I love having you here doing these presentations. I learn something every time.
Okay, so we were here and we went into our menu. And a lot of times this will remember where you were last, the preset, like in buffered memory. So we printed the visual swatch, right? We did this print label, we hit print. Swatch book was sent to the printing queue. Now we're going to have two back there. That's okay. The nice thing about this menu is that it's interactive. So I don't have to close it. I can click back here and go in my rip to hit print now, which is what we did to print this chart. When I get the recipe right there, I can hop right back into that interactive window of swatch books. We can see this patch is, you know, so many patches down and over. We can count, you know, seven rows down and six patches over, something to that effect. If it was something where, let's say we did do a one dimension of change, and when we printed this, it was the one, two, three patches from the right, just as an example to show you. If I click on that, I have a shortcut now where I can say, add that to my print mode library. It does it for me conveniently. When I click on add to print mode, it knows it's a Pantone 368 and it knows the value of that third patch over, and it's going to add that to my library of colors. Now we're going to come back to that in a moment. If this third patch over or the very end patch was starting to move in the right direction, but we need more, I can now click that and say, set that as the source, and then go back into printing my chart and reevaluating and so forth. Now, that's just a simple display with the one dimension. Yes, this being two dimensions of changes, I'd have to try to count my rows and count over. And maybe that gets a little too
foggy
with your eyes or something like that.
Color right there.
Yeah, but even if we were to click it and do that, we could still add this to the print mode. Now, having said that, we did mark off with the Sharpie, so we knew where we're at. We did mark off which patch it was and what is exactly the recipe. If this gets a bit too boggy for us to see and count patches, no worries. We could close this interactive window. Now we're done with swatch books, and we can go to our library and manually add this. And again, this is our latest version 21, gives us this interactive window and the clicking of the patch and setting it as the print mode, or iterating from there with a set of source. That's all the 21 features.
So that's only available on 21.
Yeah, our version 19, we still can bona fidely do all this, absolutely.
I was just going to say that that feature right there, I had never used that feature before, and that would save hours.
It puts it right in there for you.
Quick and easy, and you don't have a typo, you know, because you literally type one digit correctly when you're
or spell something wrong. So I'll show you the other way. If you don't have 21 and that's, you know, you're at 19, or for whatever reason you couldn't see, the chart was so big to identify which patch it is, no problem. We will go back into that color menu. We'll go to setup, rib configuration, color matching table. And here is where we're going to add that manually. Now, this is kind of the way it was in 19 and 18 and 12 and so forth.
AKA old school.
Old school.
Got it.
So swatch books and print mode defined colors work hand in hand. You notice how I move that menu up there? I got them all nice and chummy together. Swatch books and print mode defined colors work hand in hand. Swatch books is the software or the vehicle to print all those varieties. Once we find our perfect match, we're going to add that recipe to the print mode defined colors. So we're going to go to select mode. You must obey every step of the way. Pick the proper printer, pick the proper media group, the media type, and the mode that we were working with. And that was the 4-pass 360 by 720. Very, very important. Here now, I can say add, and I would name it appropriately. So you can see how I hit my caps lock on 368 spacebar C, okay?
And we're going to do
that recipe,
42.4,
tab,
96.1,
tab,
and 00.
Zero, okay. So again, exactly to the decimal placement. You might think, oh, really? But seriously, sometimes you can see a difference between. So we're going to put in exactly that recipe that's there. I hit okay. The name is spelled exactly the same name as in my little old recipe here, which would be my Pantone green somewhere in here, you know, 368. But that's named exactly the same name as that spot color. When I rip my file, I have my checkbox on by default, use spot color replacement table. That's this menu here, color matching. For this printer, this media, and this mode, I will get this recipe now applied. So I would design still with the Pantone 368C spot color all day long. When it hits the rip, it's going to recognize that the name is there in that media and that printer media and mode. That name is there. It exactly matches the design file's name, and it's going to replace that color for us.
Yep.
So that's your color replacement for Pantone. Now, going back just briefly to this screen here, I do want to mention the profile connection space. because we are using all ICC profiles on, and there is a conversion input to output. Now, this is very important to explain. So I really want to make sure that we recognize this part of the session. The recipe that prints below this patch, the recipe that is the perfect match to that color, this recipe is just for the RIP and the RIP only. You do not, I'll say it twice, it's so important. You do not give this recipe to your Illustrator people and say, hey, design it like this, 42.4, blah, blah, blah. You do not do that. You have these recipes for the RIP. When we think about what happened here, we were at the RIP to the printer and we produced these patches. It's a RIP and printer relationship. So the data goes to the RIP. All we need to do is design it as Pantone 368C, proper spelling. It's a spot color name, proper spelling, and the conversion, the swap out, the replacement will take place in the RIP because the names match. If I did give my design people this recipe, this profile connection space is going to alter it, and I'm not going to get 42.4 cyan, 0 magenta, 96.1 yellow, 0 black. I will get a different variation of that.
Yeah, the value you're seeing here on this printed swatch is an output value for the RIP for this profile. And so that the profile, when it's written, the largest component of it is your ICC, the International Color Consortium.
Yep.
And the RIP converts any color space, any design color space, to an output value. And that's what we're changing, is the output value. So we're converting it. So you wouldn't want to use the output value as an input value in your design application. So, you know, the most common design files, you're going to get files designed in CMYK. Those are not called out colors. You know, those aren't defined colors. It's, you print that on four different printers or five different printers, you're going to have four or five different colors. You know, the CMYK is just when you have an input value like that, whereas you're inputting as a spot value with a called out Pantone value, that's where the ICC, that International Color Consortium, figures out the math per output device and says, hey, to hit this color on this device, here's what I need to do. And that's where it comes up. But here's something that's, while we're on the subject of these four color, the CMYK value, because it doesn't matter the ink configuration for your printer. I saw someone earlier in the chat had put in there something about why don't printers just have green ink? It would solve a lot of problems. Something that comes up a lot, or that I hear from customers, is, hey, I'm printing on a six color, like my HP 365 has six colors. I got a light cyan, light magenta, or my Epson S80 is a nine color. I mean, I got orange, red, I got light gray, you know, it's got an extended color gamut to it. Even if I was to do this swatch book process on one of those devices, it still is only going to give me a four color value, CMYK. When it goes to print, it still uses all six or all nine or all 12 of my colors that I have in there, just to do the conversion, the math for the RIP software to give its output values. It only uses CMYK. It's still going to print with all six colors, but the formula only comes out as a CMYK conversion. So that could be a little confusing, but I hope it made sense. So
I do want to bring in the file. Now I'm grabbing this RIMCO file that we had the logo. I just want to show this. I'm not going to bring it into the queue now. This is just a different file, but one thing I want to point out, we're talking about these Pantones. We're talking about customers' files. If you're getting their native file and working it in design or something, but you may also be the RIP operator and you get these files and you're like, okay, I'm looking at this RIMCO logo. What spot colors are in there? Are there spot colors? Are there just process builds? Couple of ways to find out what are the process or spot colors in the file. If you double click or right click and go to job properties, either way, double click anywhere on that line, right click job properties, there's a named color section. This shows us the Pantone colors that are used in the file. Okay, so right there, you know the naming convention. We knew what this green was, this 368 green. But again, how do I find that information out? And sometimes you might be addressed with this. You might think it was like that gray part. Maybe I thought that gray was CMYK. Well, actually that gray is a Pantone gray or something to that effect. So how do you know what's in the name of the file? You don't have a Illustrator program. You're just the RIP guy over here working. You can always investigate by named color and find out the name of what's in the file.
Perfect.
Another thing is if I open in Job Editor, when I go into Job Editor, I can see the same information for named color. And that's going to be at the top in our toolbar, this blue circle with the white letter I, Job Properties. If you click on that, you can also go to named color and you'll see that there. So just to identify, sometimes you're wondering, what did they give me in the file? Okay.
You know what? I'm going to put it on pause right now because this is a perfect place to stop.
Oh, yes, yes. We'll come back.
Keep that file open. So we're going to take a quick, let's do a 10-minute break. Mm-hmm. So I have 10:57, so we'll come back about five after. We'll go a little less than 10-minute break. We'll get through last, leave enough time at the end for Q&A. So let's come back at five after the hour, and we'll finish up with some color management things. So everybody hold tight.
Have a great break.
I'm one of those people. So, all right, everybody, welcome back. Hope everybody's back for the break. So we're going to jump right into part two of this here. You want to go ahead and share screen? So we kind of left off looking at the Grimco logo in the Onyx Rip software. So we're gonna start off there, and want to share some of the useful tools available in Job Editor. All these tools are available in all versions of Onyx?
Or
maybe depending, maybe just point us to the ones.
Depending. Well, you'll have these features when it comes to the some of the finishing features.
I guess the color management.
Yeah, some of those aren't available in all the versions. So we'll take a look in the color correction tab in Job Editor. We'll take a look at these different items in here. I first want to start out at the bottom. Sounds silly, but sample points. Wherever your cursor is, you're going to see a sample point. Now, remember one thing. This is just a real simple way of maybe making some slight adjustments and changes to the file. If you really, really, really want power, Photoshop, Illustrator are the kingpin softwares you're going to be using, or any other vector program like CorelDRAW. So some of you out there might be using CorelDRAW, and that's fine. But if you really want to make some of these changes, major changes, you want to do this in the design end. What I'm going to show you here are going to be just a few small things we can do. And it's just a post edit to the file. That's what I want to point out, post edit to the file. So the first one we have is primary color levels, and that gives us the saturation, and you can see cyan, magenta, yellow, black. Now I'm just gonna wango tango slide this up pretty far, and you're gonna see the change reflect on the screen. The sample point menu, wherever your cursor is, you're gonna see that value before and after. Okay, so if I make a dramatic change to something, we can see that impact before and after recipe. Again, at the bottom, reset filter puts us back to the defaults, which is all zeros.
And so I'd never really used that much, because the issue is if you go to repeat that job in the future, you got to remember exactly what you did with that slider bar. So if you're doing a one-off print, you know you're never going to have to repeat the job, and you just say, hey, taking a little magenta out is going to solve all my issues. That's a great, quick, easy way of doing it. But it's going to be hard to repeat it unless you wrote down exactly what you did.
Yeah, and that's the thing. Really, you got those desktop applications that you can manipulate your file. Save them as, adjustment layers and things like that. I'm not too familiar with CorelDRAW, but you get the idea. Desktop area is controlling those changes. They're applied to the file. They're the native program's format. You can get that rinse repeat out of it again and again. So that's really the idea. Still, if you had a need to make a quick change, you can do these things here. So again, that, primary color levels is just moving our data around. This is just sliders. It's not dot percent, which is another thing. We can slide that slider. We'll see the display refresh. In the sample point, wherever I have my cursor, I can see the before and after value. So I'm kind of manipulating that slider, checking my numbers, and going back and forth until I get what I want.
And again, those are output values, not anything you'd ever want to input into a design file.
Right, exactly, right. We're at the rip. We're going to go to the printer. So we're at the back end of the process. Another choice we have is color gray levels. We have contrast changes we could make, brightness, saturation, and then changes to highlight, midtone, and shadows. So again, if you make a slide adjustment, the screen will refresh and reflect that. In our sample points, wherever our cursor is, we'll see that dot percent shift. Okay, so just to identify a few of these here, I'll reset filter back to zeros. Our third choice is white-black limits. If I activate these settings, and I even have a little histogram here for what it's worth, this is now looking more like Photoshop levels a little bit, where we can make some adjustments in here. I can set my white limit point and sample an area. This background, which should be 255 or white. If I had something that was a black point, I can press that and sample that. And then I could even do some balancing. So just to say, this is very much like levels, and you have your histogram in here to see those values as well. Okay, reset that filter. Now, color replacements and named color replacements. Color replacements will let us select the color and alter the recipe. Very simple, just like it says. So to do that, we'll make a change here. I'm going to change this gray part of the logo. I would hit the eyedropper with the plus symbol up here to make a new color replacement pair. I have a current color and a desired color. So I'm going to simply sample, press on the eyedropper, sample my current color. When I click on this gray color of the logo, it's going to go to the desired color, which are all zeros. So there's no surprise that goes to white. But then this is where I can type in a recipe, for example.
So let's change it to that Pantone 368, the color match that we printed here earlier. So let's go with 42.4.
Tab.
Zero.
Tab.
96.1.
Tab.
Zero.
And if any of you worked in this for color replacement before, what I just showed you is a new update that we can tab through all these menus. In the past, the tabbing used to just do these two, but now we can literally tab through them all. So just to say, yep, there's my recipe. If I close this, that's my pair and that's my change. Yeah.
And if anybody in our corporate office is watching, that might be a new branding guideline for the Grimco, the red and green.
Christmas colors.
There you go.
Right. No, only so many days away till Christmas.
No, let's stick with the gray. How do we change it back to gray?
Okay, so if I want to completely remove this filter, I could select it and hit remove, and that deletes that filter, and I'm back to the original component that's here. So now the other thing is we can still make edits to that color and save that out as a legitimate color recipe change. So come on, you. It's removing.
The computer knows everyone's watching.
Yeah.
So it's going slow.
We're getting there.
Let's open up one of those other files in Job Editor. That one file. There you go.
Yeah. So I'm going to take that guy and open this up in Photoshop, and then a Job Editor rather. Yeah.
So that Grimco logo, we had two Pantone values in there. You know, there are two colors called out in there. Not a lot of fun stuff happening and going on with that file. Whereas this file we're trying to pull up now.
Let's see if under my window comes up.
It's because we're doing a live broadcast. That's why we're having technical difficulties. So,
many of you might know that our local, we had a major issue in the
internet
Comcast Xfinity world. So there's a lot going on. All right, here we go. We're coming in and going back in the Job Editor. All right, so I'm going to go back into the color correction section, go back into that color replacements, make a new color replacement pair, sample your source color. And then again, I can type in something very simple. I'm just going to put in, 25 and 25 and 25. How's that? So if this was some type of a change you wanted to make permanently, we have this color replacement. We can export this out as a filter and then import it back into a quick set. So whenever I'm working with this Grimco logo, I can replace that initial 22 cyan, 18.4 magenta, 12.2 yellow to be 25, 25, 25. So this can be a filter pair. So when I close that out, I see that filter pair there. When I want to export that out and use that, I'm going to go over here to filter and manager and export. Now it's going to ask me if I want to apply this condition. Yes, I do. Apply it to this logo. I'm going to save it to the desktop for now. The name is called Grimco logo only. That's fine. I'll leave the name there and I'll hit save. All right, then I'm just going to close this out and hit okay. So that filter is if I double click this recipe over here, I'll open it back up again. That filter change is an exact recipe of that source color. Remember, that Grimco gray part of the logo started out as 22 cyan, 18.4 magenta, 12.2 yellow. whenever this filter encounters this recipe exactly to the decimal, it'll replace it with 25, 25, 25. So that's a process color swap out, if you will. Now for that, I'll complete this cycle. I'll submit this. And we're going to go into talking about adding that as in the quick set as a filter to permanently be there. So we'll go through and we'll complete this cycle. Let's see, that file's there. So I'm going to go into, actually, I'll just edit my quick set just to show you. I'll edit the quick set. The location to bring in that filter is going to be in the quick set. It's going to be in the advanced area. And that's under color correction. Remember, we were working with color correction. And you can see color correction filter. There's no filter. We're just going to import that. I'll browse to my desktop, find my filter, and bring it in. So in the quick set, I would have this filter. Now you can make a new quick set, call it Grimco logo color replacement or something, and have it specifically to its own quick set. I just edited the default to show you, you know, real quick way of doing that. But now that would permanently be there. Remember how that initial recipe has to be those values to do that color filter swap out.
Yeah. So now with that filter applied, if I was to open that file again, yes, the job editor, it'll automatically...
It'll apply it and be there. So we'll see that filter there.
So that gray should come up as 25, 25, 25, not...
Yep. So if I go to color correction
and sample point...
Nope, I just go right back into my color placement. There it is. If I double click it, you see the recipe. Yep. Or as you say, you could still do sample point, and wherever you put your cursor, you'll see the recipe. Now before, if I don't even have my color correction or my sample point open, remember, if you're not aware of this, I'll point this out to you. Wherever your cursor is, along the very bottom where the slider is, below that slider, you're gonna see the CMYK recipe. So wherever your cursor is, you'll see the recipe makeup of that color. So you can see 25, 25, 25 for that gray color, wherever your cursor is. Okay.
So what other, the named color replacement.
So named color replacement. I'm going to go ahead and remove that filter pair just because, and I'm going to go into named color replacement. Now named color replacement, we know we have a spot color in here, a Pantone color. So when I hit that plus symbol with the eyedropper, I'm going to get a list of all the Pantone colors in this file. And there's the two. So if I wanted to, I could select that color and actually change the recipe here. Okay, so named color is going to call up the directory list of all the spot colors in your file. If I had logo red and I had a part of this colored with logo red, I would see logo red. I have Pantone, so I see my Pantones in here, the two Pantones that are applied. So one more point to make here, or move that out. One more point to make is in the color replacements. We talked about swatch books. We talked about launching swatch books from the main RIPQ. If I go into my color replacements and I eyedropper or sample a color, now maybe I'm curious about that sample current color of that gray, or maybe I do need to match that red, that Pantone color. I can initially sample that to load it into my library, but if you look down here in the lower left corner, I could also engage in swatch books. Same menu, same program. In swatch books now, I can say, yep, I want to make a one-dimension change based on, you know, lightness and plus or minus degree of change at 10. If I print this visual swatch, add my label, checked on, swatch book has been sent to the printing queue. I'm in Job Editor, separate program. All I gotta do is flip screens back into my RIPQ. I see my file here. I can print that long patch change that I've got, evaluate it like we did here, go back into Job Editor. I can still select the patch if I, you know, can clearly identify. I can select that patch and add to my print mode, or set as source and deviate and go further and further. But the idea is I'm in Job Editor, so I can be interacting back and forth to the RIPQ and Job Editor. Once I get that recipe and I like what I see here, you know, I could add that to my print mode library of colors. And let's say that that's, you know, logo red or something. I can give that a special name, add that to the library. It's been added and I'll have that take place. So again, it's something where I can do this, also engage in this through Job Editor and swatch books, still add the library of color, you know, print mode defined colors. Or maybe this is a one-off. I'm only going to print this now, get this color to match, never see this job again. And I don't even need to save it, right? Yeah, for the data. All right, now let's take a look at this guy. I'll open, take him off.
I think you might have to open up.
Oh yeah, I got that one's on the desktop, I think, right?
No.
You drive. You know your directories.
I actually may not know this one, but we'll see what I got. Mardi Gras, right?
Yes, there you go.
Amazing me, I can find anything some days.
So this will be a good example to show this particular file, very colorful, right? On the left side with our color correction tools that we have, we're in the printer and media tab. Our preset, our quick set, all ICC profiles on. If I turn that to all ICC profiles off and hit apply, this is going to re-render based on that color management setting and make that change. So dramatically different. I mean, what we can see on our screen, hopefully the audience, you can see as well, dramatically different effect, impact effect.
And just to kind of reiterate what we were talking about earlier, if you wanted to make changes in here, like say I had a weird gradient and something I wanted to change my rendering intent, all of that would be done here. So you go back in, let's turn all ICC profiles on, and then we can go in here, apply here, we'll see the change take place. And we want to change, you know, something to match our input, you know, the number of box of crayons that we had going in there. We want to make sure we're matched up here and then maybe try a different rendering intent to be more into that color space that we want to be in. We hit OK here, apply again, and see what changes take place. And really what you're seeing on your screen may not be accurate to what your output device is going off. You may have to run a couple small sample pieces, but it's just a simple matter of just playing around with that rendering intent. What I wanted to show here was some of the tools that we were showing in that last segment where you're doing color replacement. It's not going to work with a picture. You know, a picture is not raster. A solid color. So if I wanted to replace, say I didn't like the yellow in here, let's remove that one here. Say I didn't like the yellow of the mask in here, I can't use the eyedropper tool and go in here and say, oh yeah, change this yellow, because that yellow is not a solid color yellow. It's a picture. Pixel. It's a whole bunch of small little pixels in there. And so it's not going to be very effective to do color change in here. And so in this case, you know, your best options are probably working maybe a little bit in your primary colors, you know, do a minus plus of some color combination here, get that shift that you're looking for, or go back to your design software and change that value in your design software, because the abilities here just aren't going to work with images so much. So.
Yeah, definitely the color replacement, name color replacement is geared towards vector color information, not pixel-based raster files for that effect.
So what do you think about covering Gamma Record tool?
Yes.
Oh, did we cover, there was a question that popped up in the chat earlier. Oh, someone was asking about how do you make the adjustment for lamination? So you print a bunch of prints and then you apply a lamination to it. Obviously, your lamination is going to play an effect on your final image. So when you're doing this color matching process, you're trying to hit a particular brand color, you're going to do some color adjustment to it, you definitely want to apply that lamination before you go pulling out your Pantone book and matching up colors. Once you come up with that value with your lamination applied to your printed swatches and you figure out what the mix is, how would you go about resetting?
Yeah, so again, that could even be what we're here with this primary color levels and adding some type of filter for that effect, for that color effect.
To compensate for the lamination. Yeah.
And again, it's going to be a matter of we could be seeing dot percent here. So if I go into my sample point and we'll just say, you know, plus 20 yellow and see.
Yeah, if it's giving too much yellow, or, you know, I guess that would, you take one unlaminated, one laminated, and see if you can get close to it, and then you figure out the filter, and then apply a filter just like we did to change the Grimco color in there, and then it always, you have a filter that applies with lamination, you know, and it's going to vary by matte lamination, gloss lamination, every different supplier of laminate, but yeah, it's a fact of matter that applying lamination is going to change your color. Light metamorisms, all kinds of other things
there
too.
Go. That was a big impact. Yeah. So I went from 0 to 70. I mean, that's just for a visual effect, right? There it is at 0. If I said 70, it gives me that effect. Okay. And that's what I want to represent.
Right.
Well, this is again where I can go to filter and manager and I can export that out. I'm going to apply it to the file Mardi Gras. There's another thing about this. When we're exporting out this filter, it takes the file name Mardi Gras, but this might be, you know, lamb yellow or something. and then I'm going to save that out. Now I might, you know, apply this to my quick set whenever I want that to be represented.
Right.
So it's something that you can do if that's a type of a global effect you want to make to be applied post design. You're at the RIP level.
Yeah. So you're not having to make adjustments every single time. You just want, you know, you're going to laminate. You know that this lamination gives too much yellow or not enough yellow, whatever direction it is. Mm-hmm. Create that filter and then go with it from there. Yeah. So just a real quick note, guys, we are going to open up. We're going to end in about another 20 minutes or so here. So if you have questions, please drop them in the Q&A so we save ourselves time. We're going to get 15 minutes at the end to answer some questions. So as you're thinking about them now, start typing them out so we can make sure we cover everything. But I hope that answers that yellow lamination issue.
Mm-hmm. All right. So let's talk about the gamut report. We know that in Onyx, we have a library of colors, Pantone color recipes. We know we have all those Pantone recipes described in Onyx. So Pantone has a known value, known recipe formula, and we have our profile, whatever our profile happens to be. So when we take a look and do this comparing, a Pantone color should be this recipe in LAB, and what is our profile's representation of that Pantone in LAB, we're going to get a value. Remember the difference we talked about in the very beginning, the difference of our color, our delta E's. So when we go into Media Manager, got it open here. We're going to go into Media Manager in the software, and we're going to go into Reports and Tools, and we're going to talk specifically about this gamut report.
Now, I always like this tool because without even printing something, it lets me kind of analyze what my chances are, what I might have to do to this specific file, this specific print mode, heck, even what printer I may print a certain job on. So this lets you look at, hey, my design file, I know this Grimco, whatever our Pantone value is, 7642, whatever the number is. I know these guys are real picky on this color. They really like that branded color, and I got to hit this red color. It lets me look at my all of my printers available as well as the print modes available, and lets me kind of do some math ahead of time to know what my options might be or what I might have to do. So I pull up the machine. So I got my working still with my Epson S40, you know, four color CMYK device. I'm going to print it on IJ35 at four pass print mode, and it lists out the Pantone values and the expected delta E. So the delta E is a variation of color. Good rule of thumb is anything less than three delta E's is going to be hard for the human eye to distinguish the difference. Anything, you know, five to six delta E's variation, if they're not standing right next to each other, nobody's going to notice the difference. When you get above about six delta E's, that's when it becomes really noticeable, the difference.
Yeah.
But this gamut report analyzer lets me quickly look at my device and print modes and see the delta E's. So I always like the coded at the top.
Coded.
I look at the coded, and that lets me know, hey, within all delta E's of this machine and this print mode, I'm about 86% accurate. You know, less than two delta E's, anybody's going to look at it and say, oh yeah, that's what that color is supposed to look like. But then you can scroll down to the bottom and look at specific Pantone values and see exactly where that falls. So my design file, you know, I looked at my name color replacements. I see that Pantone color is called out, and it lets me look on this device using this print mode. This is how close I am to hitting that color accurately. Mm-hmm. So, you know, say I got something crazy and it's like seven, eight delta E's away. I got to change. I got to make a change without even printing something. I know it's not going to print accurately. And so the first thing I can do is kick up my print mode. You know, this is printing at four pass, which is really fast and great, but it's not the color accuracy. So I go to the opposite end of the spectrum, and I go to the highest. Yeah, let's go 16. Oh, 16. Let's go crazy.
Okay, 16 pass.
So 16 pass. And so this is maximizing the gamut of this machine. You can see just right off the bat, my coded jumps out to about 80, almost 88% there. And then I can look at that specific Pantone value and see what it did to get me closer to that. So if I saw a Pantone delta E variation of about six, it kind of lets me know, hey, I can do some, print some swatches, and I'll be able to adjust to that color. If it was less than three, I may not even do anything. I'll just print it right off the bat. So it kind of guided me in which direction I wanted to run.
So this tool could be your shopping ahead of time for the Pantone color and finding out with that particular media profile and mode, where do I sit? And if I'm in a good position, I know I'm good. If I'm not, I know I got some work to do.
Yeah. And so here, let me drive for just a second. If I jump over the Epson S80 here, so if I jump over the Epson S80 is a nine color device. So it's got, light cyan, light magenta. It's got a gray. It's got orange, red, a bunch of really amazing colors in here. Let me choose a similar print mode. Oops, that is not the similar print mode. White film. Here we go. Okay. And I go with the same, you know, we'll go with the six pass here. And I run that gamma report. And it lets me know right off the bat, hey, delta E is within less than two. Coded Pantone values less than two. I'm at 92% right out of the box at a very low print mode. Kick it up to 16 pass. It doesn't get much better because even at low print modes, it's got a pretty good. Yeah. So we're pretty high in there. But then I could look at, okay, I got to hit this Pantone 100C, a really bright, vibrant yellow. We're good to go there. So really kind of nice. You take any of your devices here and run the gamut and see what might be the best option available for you here. So,
and remember, these are known values, right? Pantone is a known LAB. The profile is a result of that. And so we can kind of do that comparison to come up with the report from this.
Was there something else at Swatchbooks we wanted to cover?
Yes. So one more thing as a last honorable mention. In Swatchbooks, if we do have a spectrophotometer and we want to measure off of our source object. So maybe I don't have a Pantone colored client, just gives me the sample and says, match this grain, right? Okay, so I can go into Job Editor, sample off of here, but in LAB, I can actually measure that color.
Real quick, I want to share. I assume not everybody knows what a spectrophotometer is.
Oh yeah, for sure.
But I just want to cover it. So this is X-Rite spectrophotometer. There's a couple Barbieri, there's a couple manufacturers on the market that do this, but basically it's a color reading device or color measuring device that allows you to take a look at color, objectively given an analysis of it. So a couple, this is the actual reader itself, calibration pad where there's a known white point on here. And so I'm gonna calibrate the device to that white point, which kind of resynchronizes it. It's reading an absolute white. And then from here, I take a nice little device and this device here is gonna isolate that color. So when I close it down on top here, it's gonna isolate that color, place it on my color that I'm trying to read, press a button, it's going to shoot some light out there, read the reflected color coming back to it, and then give me a lab value or a reading of that, that device. So if you want to get really, really good with color management and be as accurate as possible, as quick as possible, getting a spectrophotometer is definitely the way to go. It will take your eyes out of the equation. It takes the light in your room out of the equation to a degree. It eliminates some variables. Not 100% necessary. I mean, you can get pretty darn good color just using some of the tools in Onyx.
And we illustrated with the visual method. That's still a very valid way of finding color. But another way we have is by using a spectrophotometer, we can measure in the LAB source color off of an object and load that into the palette, if you will, and then deviate our swatches based onto that. In version 21, we also enhanced our swatch books. I'm just going to go back into my spot color and browse for a color. Okay, back to that 368 guy again. All right. So another area we have that deals with the spectrophotometer is besides this visual swatch method, we can do a measurement method. Now we do a measurement patch method. We're printing patches, but then instead of us visually evaluating and isolating areas and identifying what that color is going to be.
Using our eyeballs.
Yeah, using our eyes, our beautiful eyes. We can actually be measuring with the spectrophotometer. And this is going to generate a report. And the report is going to say, this patch was a delta E of something. This patch was a delta E of something. It's going to give you a report of the delta E values per patch. And it'll sort them automatically, lowest at the top. Let's say we did this whole method with the measurement and we come across the lowest number is 0.3 delta E. And then from there it goes up. Well, we can select right on that patch, 0.3 delta E, and add that to our print mode defined color. Or if our delta E's are too high, we can select the lowest of the choices and go set a source and deviate and go further from there. So we have the same like functions and tools that we do visually, but instead of being visual, we're being measured. So, and again, Pantone colors are known LAB recipes. When we measure with our spectrophotometer, it's going to compare what that patch's LAB is compared to the Pantone, and that's going to do the calculation for the delta E. So just to say, that's information also for you if you happen to have one. You know, that's how we can use this also as a measurement method within Swatch books. And again, that's in version 21.
Yeah. And the other nice benefit of having a spectrum photometer, it allows you to create custom ICC profiles. Mm-hmm. Again, all use, you can do it right through the Onyx program. Mm-hmm. That is a way deep dive. We can't wrap that up in about 2 hours, right? How long would you say it takes? In my experience, it takes about an hour per print mode to create a custom ICC profile.
We'd have to probably those print samples ahead of time and kind of...
Right, and dig into it. So that color math, that color formula that allows me to print, you know, images of my Epson S40 and use these source values. Basically, you're rewriting that color math that goes from this input value to this output value and lets you source that thing. So having an I1, writing a custom profile, it really lets you dial it in. So, but again, it's a much more deep dive into color management, and you're creating custom profiles. All the profiles I have here for the Epson system, they're downloaded from the Epson Edge dashboard. HP has it available through their online portal, and these are already custom or prefabricated print modes I've been using. So,
yeah, and again, remember all that we've talked about with Onyx and Swatch books, whether it's the visual method or the measurement method. This information's on the Onyx website, onyxgfx.com. That's George Frank X-Ray. You can go there, you can log into a My Onyx account. There's documentation, there's videos, and you'll be able to see some of this reference material as well. The documentation on Swatch books gives more information, kind of like we're talking about, to remind you as far as the conditions and the settings and the definitions and terms. So there's always that document that you can refer to in the future as well.
And, you know, we want to mention if a customer wants to deep dive more into being able to create their own profiles, how else can they go about that?
Yeah, so with Onyx, we offer a profiling web class. And so we do go through the definitions and the terms and the steps as we go through and create that profile, what each type of test target is and what it's doing, using the spectrophotometer, measuring, and it's actually this exact model, the I1 Pro 2 handheld device. But again, any spectrophotometer that's on our list of supported spectrophotometer color devices will work. So we do offer a class for basics in creating a profile. We also have on-site services, you know, that type of thing
and
as well.
And all that information is
on our website.
Myonyx.com.
You can go to our website, go to the training page, and the information will be there as well. Okay. So as far as that, for that, how that goes.
All right.
But so hopefully, like I said, the session was good for you to see some information about matching these spot colors. There's a lot that could go on in the world, but there's a lot that we can do to get that target value.
Yeah. All right. So we're gonna deep dive into some of the questions that came through here. Again, it's not too late to ask some questions. If you got something, please type it in. We'll take this one first off here. Relative color metric, what happens with out of gamut colors that are moved into gamut?
Okay, so your relative color metric, remember I got that little tiny guy here.
Oh,
sorry. you drive.
There we go. So the question was, with relative color metric, what happens to out of gamut colors that are moved into the gamut? And so we'll reference back to this guy here.
Yeah, so this particular this depiction or representation, and these are just some you can Google up your use your Google Foo and look up color rendering intents and you'll get some information. These are some of the images that I got off the internet too. But when we're thinking about the relative color metric methods, whatever value is in the source and it can fit into the destination, so that exact representation of that LAB value in the source will be mapped to the exact LAB representation of the destination. Anything that's beyond that range, that's going to be, the color will be just brought to the very edge, okay? So that's just going to be brought to the edge. Colors are only represented in as they are appropriately matched to the in input to output exact match. But those colors that are out of gamut, those are actually going to be just brought to that very edge of that representation. So they're not shifting any color that's in that representation. Relative color metric, it's what we can reproduce. We're reproducing exactly, but anything that's out of gamut is just brought to the very edge. So there's really no color shift per se. We're not getting a change in that representation of color.
Yes. All right. So next question up here is when, let's see, this, it feels like an episode of Stump the Chumps again. Like, oh yeah, let's see if they can answer this live. So when working with a linked file in Illustrator, does it affect the spot color Pantones when sent to the printer?
So the linked file is a vector spot color of a Pantone? I'm wondering if that's what you're asking.
I've ran into this issue before. So I guess the question is, what is it going to do to the Pantone values, or how are your Pantone values affected by that? The easiest way to tell what's happening, and this is how I would approach it, I guess. This may not be the right answer. I love when I start that. Let me try to share my screen. This is the way I would approach it, and pretty much the way I approach most jobs when I'm working with unknown variables, is I would open that job in a job editor. And then the first thing I'm going to do, let's work with this. Let's pretend it's an actual image. And I'm going to open this up in here, and I'm going to go to my color correction tab.
That does not work. Never mind.
Let's grab a real image.
Open up another file or something. Yeah, that guy's good.
So the first thing I'm going to do in Job Editor is just take a look and see what's happening with this file. And again, you can do this without having to go, 100% not. So that's why there's two of us here, right?
We help each other.
Yeah. All right, there we go. Okay, so I'm going to open this file into Job Editor. And I'm going to take a look at, first things I would do is my named color replacement. And there's nothing in here. There's no name color.
It's an image. It's not a spot color.
And I would probably go to my sample point tool. And here's something. Let me find that Grimco image that had. You know that there's Pantone values in here. Okay. So say this was a linked image in Illustrator.
There you go.
Let's look at this guy. So first things first, go to my color correction tab. And I'm going to say, hey, name colors. So if it recognized, if these pop up, those two Grimco Pantone values popped up, I know that it applied correctly. The other cool thing.
Properties up here too.
Oh yeah, we can reach that here. So name properties, and it'll pop up here as well.
Name color on the left.
There we are.
They'll show you the same thing.
So if it popped up, I know that they're applying correctly. The other thing that I do periodically, I have my sample point tool open, which is available here. Tools, filters, turn on that sample point. And then I'm going to go here and I'm going to turn all ICC profiles off. So that takes out the color math of Onyx reading those things and says, hey, it's not going to read it. I'll scroll over here and see what it does to my values. So for my gray, I got 22, 18, 12, 2. And then I turn all ICC profiles on and do that exact same. I have to hit apply to render the image down and then take a look at that value. So sometimes when you're doing these minor color swaps here, I get rid of my gray altogether because we have the filter in here.
Yeah.
So, there we go. All right. But using that sample point tool to quickly look at things to see how it affected, ICC's on, here's what I'm getting. Mm-hmm. ICC's off, here's what I'm getting. Did something change in that named color? So I hope that was helpful. Did you use PDF files? You suggest PDFX. Why for color management? Yeah, so file type is a question I get a lot of times. Customers submit files in here for the demo center. They want to see custom sample prints. Onyx can handle pretty much anything.
Yeah, for the most part, when we bring a file into the RIP queue with the open command, I don't know if you've ever explored this before, but at the bottom, at the bottom, we default to all Onyx Thrive Job / image files, but you can see in the pull down list, there's a large directory of possible file formats. So naturally, our RIP products are using the Adobe PDF Print Engine or API. So we're using the Adobe RIP engine, which is Adobe based, and our PDF information is fully supported. So you can use your PDF file formats to work through with your data for that, for color management. The information that you have, applied, embedded into the file is going to come across when it goes into our RIP queue, depending on how our QuickSet color management section is set up, all ICC profiles on, use spot color replacements. That's where your color management is going to be engaged in your information. So definitely we support the PDF file workflow.
PDF, TIFF, JPEG, EPS, you name it, Corel Draw. Someone was saying they work with Corel Draw because they're not a fan of Adobe products. Onyx will support it all and has the color rendering to support it as well. And so it's just matching whatever you're working in, whatever your input was, having that match. So your box of crayons match up.
Right.
Do the best with your
color. Yeah, having your color management input to output, being established, whatever you want that to be, but establishing that and making sure everybody's in a good, consistent way of working is also one of those critical points.
What is the best, though, if you had to give an answer?
I would work with PDF.
PDF is portable document.
Format. So the situation is there's different flavors with the PDF versions and formats. So again, you can work with the setting the highest version format that you're, depending on what your Creative Suite's at, right? What you're working with, what will hold through. But again, we work with the Adobe PDF Rip Engine, and that information is going to honor and accept that data. Some people will like to work with TIFF files or EPS or JPEG files. There's a lot of different things in color that we have to be concerned about. The fact that you can embed information, the fact that spot color information will be honored and represented, that type of thing. So there's also those types of aspects when it comes into thinking about the file format to work with.
So the next question, all the color management steps we've reviewed are best achieved with Onyx Thrive or the latest version of Onyx. So the different versions of Onyx, you know, Onyx 21 is the
21.1.1 right now. We've always had the color management choice in the quick set, all ICC profiles on or off. We've always had the spot color replacement table. That's always been a given. The swatch books and the print mode defined color, that whole feature came out in version 11. So I don't think anybody would be that older of a version. But if you are older than 11 and you don't have the swatch books feature, then, you know, get upgraded and you'll have the component to do this. I think nowadays everybody's at a more recent version, if anything, 19 or 18.
But if anything, that's the reason why you want to stay current.
Yeah, like definitely.
The latest
yeah.
and greatest. I've noticed, you know, so our Epson machines ship with a version of Onyx Gamma Print, which is real basic. And it's the same engine that drives color. Just some of the tools aren't available. Like you were saying about the finishing marks and things like that aren't available. But having current is good.
Yeah.
What else we got here?
When measuring printed patches from backlit material, namely Brightline Matte, do you need to make sure the film is on a white background?
Yeah, that's a great question. So if you're working with any kind of transparent backlit self-adhesive is going to be on a white backer paper. But yeah, when you pull away that backer paper, your color is going
to
be different.
So when it comes to things like a backlit material, and this is going to go directly to thinking about using a spectrophotometer. If you're going to be measuring patches and whether they're these types of patches or whether they're patches in a profile, you're making your own profile, you can measure transmissively through your material. So I know the new X-Rite i1 Pro 3, Pro 3 Plus, I believe, has a transmissive method for generating a profile or doing readings. You can read through. There's like a backlit box that they have for this. But other devices like the Barbieri, those can definitely read through material.
Yeah.
If you are looking to peel away the backing, like you say, because the backing is just a backing, it's not really white, then, and you want to read reflectively, the base white of your print sample is literally the fifth color in a four color process. So you have to be very careful with what you use back there if you're going to read a peeled back clear material as a reflective material.
And especially if it's going to be something that you're going to eventually backlight, the actual color spectrum of the light that's coming from it is going to play a key. So that sounds like a way fun project. I would love to be involved with that.
So if you decide to peel away the backing, because that backer might have a cast to it and it might not be as white as you think it is, and remember how your base white is color represented, maybe you do put this to some type of base white material, but what will that be? What will that actually be? And don't forget too, materials may have an optical brightening agent, which could have an impact. To make the material white look whiter, it actually might manifest itself in a measurement device, such as a spectrophotometer, as a different color hue, such as a blue. Yeah. So there's also UV cut filters we can apply. So that's a good question. If you want to keep that backlit material, that backer on there, and just measure reflectively, it all is going to depend on how that backer, white is. You know, again, what is white? We can have our sheets of paper here. We can have the print sample. We can have all these different areas of white to try to decide, but that's a very good question.
And we take all of this and we take it outside in the sunlight, and it's going to be a completely different shade of white.
Yeah.
So all that, the light is really, for what you're talking about, the backlight, the light to me would be the biggest factor, because, hey, this is going to be backlit, and is it going to be viewed at night when it's backlit or during the day? A little bit of experimentation, but, you know, that's how you would have to, all those factors you'd have to take into consideration when you're trying to color match to a specific film at a backlight.
So yeah, your two choices are going to be peel the backing and use a different surrogate white base to read reflectively, or keep the backing and read reflectively, or peel it away and read transmissively with a device that would read through the material. Those are really your choices. Yeah.
Next question up here is the best way to get a true representation of the screen colors in comparison to your output device.
All right. So calibrating your monitor.
Okay.
We've got the spectrophotometers. Yep. They have a device on here that we can use to measure and calibrate your monitor. Now, this is X-Rite's i1 Pro device. They have their software, i1 Profiler, and that can do display profiling. So we can literally be creating a profile on our monitors. Having a calibrated monitor so that you can look at your monitor and look at your proof sample, print sample, and compare the two is a big benefit. It's a big benefit. But also, when you go to calibrate your monitor, there are a lot of different aspects to situations to take into consideration. Your monitor age, yeah, right? Is your monitor displaying evenly, or are there hot spots? And again, X-Rite's website, they have tips on monitor calibration. A wonderful resource. They have videos on how to go through the procedure, so you can watch this ahead of time. The ambient light is going to have an impact. We're in this beautiful demo center. There are windows open. Some are shaded, some are open. So if we were to literally want to create a display profile and calibrate this monitor, we would have to take into consideration those windows. Maybe we turn them down and we don't let the daylight impact. The overhead lighting could have an impact as well. So there's a lot of different factors, but absolutely having some type of a calibrated display could be a benefit for how we view our.
And even
color.
If you don't go through the to sync exactly what you see on your screen to what your output device is, just the fact of calibrating your screen, it gives you a known constant.
Yes.
Because I did this in our production shop. We had a couple designers that had their screens all calibrated to each other, and then in the production setting, we calibrate our screen. So what I saw on the screen wasn't always what came out of the device, but what I saw on the screen was consistent.
Right, right.
And that really helps you. Okay, this is my print is coming out to magenta, and when I make the adjustment on my screen, boom, it lets me get to that happy place a lot quicker. So,
cool. Question: is Onyx compatible with Corel, as it is with Adobe to create the ICC color profiles? Okay, so when we're talking about creating a color profile in Onyx, we're not really using any of the Adobe programs. We're just to our software in the RIP to the printer. We're just creating these color chart samples in Media Manager. We're just generating this profile. Now, CorelDRAW and Illustrator, to compare the two, really, it's a design program. Any of the stuff we talked about today, you can make a spot color swatch in Corel and maybe use a Pantone library or not. You're fully functioning like Illustrator. That's the name of the game. Got to create a spot color that's going to be representing, you know, logo red or, you know, My Sky Blue or Coke Red or Pantone color. That's fine. But when it comes to creating a profile, the real media profile is from a RIP to printer relationship. How we apply color management, though, I'm not familiar with CorelDRAW's color management settings. Maybe do some investigating on the CorelDRAW side. We took a look at Adobe Edit Color Settings. There's got to be some type of preset like that in CorelDRAW, I would imagine.
Right.
I would imagine.
Yeah. They just match your box of credits. Yeah. So next question came up is, when we were talking about rendering intent. So it's what settings did we say when you're trying to print an image with transparencies or gradation? I don't have a solid answer on here because I've tested a bunch of different files to make it work correctly, and it's been something different every single time. Basically, what I was trying to say is when you go to use that, just try printing your image. You've got a gradient transparency. This is typically the case where the customer created the artwork, and you have no idea what the makeup of this artwork is. And so I imagine this had a transparency or a gradation, and I'm getting hard break lines, like it didn't translate correctly. Just go through here and create, you know, all ICC profiles on and try your rendering intent. So this is where I've had success. So it, by default, it sets up to perceptual. Go ahead and change it to relative, and then print a little section, see if it fixed your gradation problem. Sometimes the problem's so bad that you actually see it in your, so we go ahead and change everything to relative, you hit it here, and you'll actually see it in your preview. So the preview we're getting on the job editor function, it's, you know, it's a decent preview, but you'll see that lot, those lines and the gradation go away just by changing your rendering intent. So I don't have a hard answer of, oh yeah, relative works every time. Sometimes it's relative, sometimes it's saturation. It's all about that rendering intent and how it's going to interpret that file. Again, the most easiest way is to be in control of how that artwork was created, so that you know how to match those files, or you know how to match your intent to how it was designed. But that's not always the realistic how things work. So
yeah, a lot of times I look at it when there's issues in a gradient or banding or stepping. You want to take the easy stuff first, right? Is the printer printing properly? Is there something going on with the printer that I'm getting these steps? And then the second thing is, what's the design file like? How is the design file created? And then the third step, how is my profile? If I made a profile and I'm using my handheld device and I'm maybe not quite measuring properly, I'm lifting the device or something when I'm measuring, or some kind of an operator error when the profile was made, maybe the profile is not as smooth as it could be, so it's not representing the data. There's a lot of things to kind of get into maybe first before, you know, it's just a logic tree, right? Going through the steps,
right.
You know, make sure the printer's in good shape first, and how's the file design? If all those things are good, then we can maybe pick apart some settings within the processing data.
So the next two questions revolve around G7 certification. So can you explain what G7?
Yeah, so... G7 is an industry standard. You can go to IdeaAlliance.org and you can see some information about G7. Some companies out there want to subscribe to going through a G7 standard. There'll be G7 process control charts that we print and measure, and we see if we pass or fail. So a lot of times when it comes to G7, you already want to establish G7. You could use some type of software that's out there already for G7 and print those charts, measure it, do a calculation. So this could be like a Curve 3 software or something to that effect. But in Onyx, we actually are able to engage in doing a correction cycle and then a evaluation pass-fail cycle within the profile. So when you create a profile in Onyx through Onyx software, we can actually add these additional G7 steps, print the correction cycle, measure, and then the next step is a verification. We want to print and verify that we passed G7. So this could be something that's within Onyx, or this could be something that you're using another third-party software to generate that data. In the quick sets, we've been talking about all ICC profiles on or off. There's also one in there called recommended G7 profiles, and that's pretty much going to be your Grackle standard and your Adobe 1998 standard. And again, you could pick those settings as you like, or have them, you know, manually set them or go with the preset. Yeah. And there is some documentation on G7 within our website in the MyOnyx documentation section.
So onyxgfx.com.
Yep. And then log in to make a MyOnyx account or log into your MyOnyx account. In the upper left corner, they'll give you a MyOnyx tab, and you'll see MyOnyx and documentation. And then there's several pages of data, and in there will be the information pertinent to G7 as well.
All right, quickly, we got 1 minute left. I don't want to keep you guys past your time here. So I'm going to try to combine these next two questions into one. So the first question is it better to design files in RGB or CMYK? It's best to design them in Pantones, but that's not always realistic. Do you got a preference, RGB, CMYK?
All right, so this is the great debate. I love this question.
It's like, CMYK, RGB, no?
So here's my take on it.
It doesn't matter. You can do either?
It all depends on what you're trying to do. Okay. So I do know of some companies, their idea is, hey, I'm printing in CMYK, I'm going to design in CMYK. And then I know what my values are, total link limits and stuff like this. I know what my values are in my file. I'm going to pass that through and print, and I'm going to get an expected result. And that's perfectly fine. It really is. However, another side of that could be that if I work in RGB, I'm starting with as large of a color gamut going into my workflow, my RIP workflow, as possible. And depending on what we're printing like and what we need to do, do I need to be accurate, relative color metric? Could I be pleasing color, perceptual? Do I need to be saturated? All of these things can come into play with what your output needs are. So if I start with RGB, I've got all this color space, I'm going to pass it through my RIP, and I'm going to go to my printer, and hopefully, like we saw with the GAP report, hopefully my printer has a very large output capability, and I could represent most of that color, or maybe all of that color. So you kind of have two sides of it, not really to say one or the other. It is going to depend on what you're doing.
Yeah, and tell me if I'm full of it. The question earlier about calibrating your screen, so what you see on your screen is what you're seeing in your output. If you're working in RGB, aren't you more likely to see your screen representation on your print output?
Yes, because the monitors are RGB display, right?
Okay.
But on the other hand, we also, in our desktop programs, share screen, I got this.
We're already over time.
So. I know. But in our desktop applications, remember Photoshop and so forth, we do have a view proof setup where you can view in your proofing colors as well. So, and again, that's an Adobe thing, but just to throw it out there for conversation, you can also represent that on your monitor as well, as well as having a calibrated monitor.
And then the last question, which I thought would tie in quicker, was how to keep grays consistent. And so that's what today's class was all about, is, you know, pay attention to your naming convention or how your files are created, and then synchronizing that with your RIP software, as well as your, you know, starting with really good profiles, knowing you know those profiles have been correctly built, your machine's in good condition, you know, your printhead alignment's in there. You know, you could do all this work ahead of time, and then your printheads aren't aligned. You're printing bidirectionally, and you know it's laying the dots down one direction, and it's laying it down differently the other direction. It's going to change day to day. So
process control, anything gray consistent or color consistent, process control. Right. And start small and work your way up. But all process control points need to be addressed daily. And if you can be consistent in your environment and some of these other factors and your color management settings and the media you're using and the ink you're using, there's so much to it. But good process control should maintain good, consistent results.
And I hope that we presented all of this today in a non-overwhelming fashion, because sometimes color management can feel that way. Like, oh my God, everything is a disaster and I can't print anything the correct colors. It's incremental steps. You know, it's making those changes to your whole workflow. You know, making sure you're doing your due diligence and following the right steps in the software, the hardware, the design applications all across the board to be able to give you the best results.
So. And you can see we touched on a lot, and there's still so much more to talk about. And, you know, we could be here
for
hours and days talking. We love to go over.
We're probably going to spend the rest of the afternoon talking about color anyway. So maybe we'll just keep the camera rolling. You guys can tune in for all of
it. Join us for lunch.
I want to thank everybody for joining us today. This is really incredible. So we were actually talking before we went live this morning about our next session that we're going to try to present to you guys. I'm not going to spoiler alert it until we
stay tuned,
until it's set in stone. So yeah, please hit like, subscribe on the Grimco YouTube channel, because we're going to have all this posted there eventually later. But yeah, thank you everybody for tuning in today. I hope we brought some value. So
great questions, everybody. Wonderful questions. Thank you.
All right, let's get back to it. So these banners and signs, they're not going to print themselves. So all right, thanks for tuning in.
Thanks, everybody.